Welcome and thank you all for coming. My task in these evenings is to frame the debate. And in this particular case, I want to start by quoting George W. Bush, who often proclaimed that Islam is a religion of peace. It's one of the few things he said with which President Obama is in full agreement. And it is doubtless true that the vast majority of Muslims around the world live peacefully and do not condone violent acts. Their secular concerns are dominant, making a living, raising families, educating their children. Their religion provides spiritual comfort, a source of meaning, even transcendence to their lives. On the other hand, just today, the New York Times reported that Faisal Shahzad, the Times Square bomber, said in court prior to sentencing, quote, brace yourselves, because the war with Muslims has just begun. And certainly in the past decades, the vast majority of terrorist activity has been undertaken in the name of Islam. In some respects, Islamism resembles the totalitarian movements of the first half of the 20th century, the ruthless use of violence in pursuit of ideology and power by Hitler, Stalin, Mao. Just as most of their victims were their own people, most victims of Islamist terror have indeed been Muslims. But history is replete with examples of violent minorities who have held sway over peace-loving majorities. Perhaps the relevant question for this evening is what the majority of Muslims believe. But perhaps it is whether Islam, viewed as an ideological force, is in direct opposition to Western interests and Western values. Should we respect Islam as a religion of peace, or should we accept Samuel Huntington's view that we are engaged in a clash of civilizations? Or might this be a false dichotomy? Can we honor our own traditions of pluralism and free exercise of religion and tolerance and accept that for the vast majority of Muslims it is indeed a religion of peace without compromising our ability to defend ourselves and our values against the ruthless few that wish us harm? Well, these are subtle and complex questions, and we've assembled an extraordinary panel of experts this evening to explore them. It's now my privilege to turn the evening over to our moderator, John Donvan. But before I do so, I'd like to invite a round of applause to congratulate him on his third Emmy Award.
Thank you. And I was going to ask for another round of applause for Robert Rosenkranz, and there it is. Welcome, everyone, to another debate from Intelligence Squared US. I'm John Donvan of ABC News, and once again, it is my honor to act as moderator as the four debaters you see sharing this stage with me here at the Skirball Center for the Performing Arts at New York University. Four debaters, two against two, will be debating this motion: Islam is a religion of peace. Now, this is a debate. There will be winners and losers. And you, our audience, will be acting as the judges. By the time this debate has ended, you will have been asked to vote twice, once before, and once again after the debate, on where you stand on this motion, and the team that has changed the most minds will be declared our winner. So let's go to the preliminary vote. If you go to the keypads on your seat, our motion is Islam is a religion of peace. If you are for the motion, press number one. If you are against the motion, press number two. If you are undecided, press number three. You can correct any mistake just by repressing and ignore the other numbers. And we will present the results of both votes for you at the end of the evening. And that's how we will know who our winner is. So, opening round, sorry, I'm going to put it this way. Round one is opening statements by each side, 7 minutes in turn, and I would like to begin by introducing our first speaker for the motion, Islam is a religion of peace. I'd like to introduce Zeba Khan, the only American on our panel and quite possibly the youngest debater ever to take part in an Intelligence Squared U.S. debate. Welcome, Zeba. I know that I first became aware of you when the Washington Post was running a reality game show to name America's next pundit. They had 1,400 entrants. And what place did you come in?
They had 4,800 entrants,
actually. 4,800. And you came in?
I came in second.
Well, look where you are now. Ladies and gentlemen, Zeba Khan.
Thank you. I want to express my deepest gratitude to Mr. Rosenkranz and the Intelligence Squared Forum for allowing me to speak tonight alongside such well-known and far more distinguished co-panelists. This is particularly an honor for me because, let's be honest, I haven't written a book. I'm not a regular on national TV or radio. What I have is my story. I am a Muslim American woman born and raised in Toledo, Ohio, by two very loving Indian Muslim parents. My sister, brother, and I were raised in a middle-class American home. We went to mosque on Sundays, attended Sunday school classes, and prayed the community prayer with our community of Pakistanis, Lebanese, and Syrian Muslims. When I was in high school, our mosque president was a woman who did not wear a headscarf. And it may come as a surprise to some of you, but for the entirety of my life, men and women have prayed side by side at our mosque, and both can enter the prayer hall using the same door. My parents are both very religious people, but they express their faith in different ways. My father emphasizes the devotional, and he tends to spend his time praying and reciting the Quran, whereas my mother emphasizes a more constructive approach. She uses community service and volunteering to express hers. But what they both share is fundamental Islamic principles. First and foremost, seek knowledge. They urge their children, all three of us, to question, to have critical minds, and to doubt. They wanted us to engage fully with our faith and to question everything. They lived out the Quranic commandment that there is no compulsion in religion, and also that God said in the Quran, I made you into many tribes so that you might know one another. And as such, they enrolled me and my siblings in a Hebrew day school for 9 years, where we learned Hebrew, read the Torah, and prayed in a synagogue almost every morning. They always wanted us to learn about other faiths, and they always made sure that we knew the difference, though, between Islam and Judaism. But they always made sure we also respected our Jewish sisters and brothers in faith. My story is just one of 1.5 billion stories in some 57 countries. The Muslim population is one of the most diverse and eclectic in the world. We are Sunnis, we're Shias, and even in the Shia tradition, there are Zaydis, Ismailis, Ithna Asharis. There are numerous madhabs or schools of thought and Sufi mystic orders. Like Christians and Jews, Muslims can be observant, non-observant, reformist, humanist, secularist, extremist, mainstream, and there are even some Muslims who consider themselves culturally Muslim but are actually atheist. Now, the motion for you tonight is asking you to determine whether Islam is a religion of peace. And at first blush, that might seem a bit tricky to decide. After all, the Quran and the Hadith have verses in them that point to peace and justice and love. But there are other verses that are about violence against specific people. So how then do we reconcile these seemingly contradictory verses? How then do we decide whether Islam is a religion of peace? The only way to answer that question is to take an honest look at the people who practice the faith and how they interpret it. According to Gallup's groundbreaking study on what a billion Muslims think, 93% of Muslims around the world are peaceful, mainstream Muslims. 7% are what Gallup terms as politically radicalized. And within that 7%, there's a smaller percent that has succumbed to the use of violence. Any percent is too much, but we must remember that the violent minority of a minority are motivated by politics, not religion. As Gallup concluded, what distinguishes the politically radicalized Muslims from the mainstream Muslims is their politics, not their piety. Robert Pape, a University of Chicago political scientist, further confirmed this in his book, Dying to Win, in which he came to the same conclusion, that the actions of terrorists are politically motivated, not through religion. The Tamil Tigers, for example, which are predominantly a Hindu group, used and pioneered the use of suicide bombing, did so for secessionist reasons, not for religious goals. Our opponents would have you believe that there's a take-all, no-winners clash between Islam and the West, and that Muslims who try to balance their Western values and Islam arrive at a state of cognitive dissonance and are left either mute or crazy by this internal struggle. That description doesn't resonate for me, or for my family, or for my friends, or for my community, because those two aspects of our identity were never in conflict with each other and were never introduced to us as in conflict with each other. I didn't realize that there were people out there who wondered whether people, Muslims like me, existed or could exist until after 9/11. Let me be clear. There are some horrifically violent criminals out there who twist our faith to justify their hate and their violence. But I'm here to tell you, they don't speak for Islam. Mohammed Hamdani, a first responder who died on 9/11, speaks for Islam. Hassan Askari, a Brooklyn Muslim who stepped in on the subway and saved a complete stranger who was being physically attacked because he was Jewish, he speaks for Islam. Zainab Selby, through her organization Women for Women International, has assisted over 250,000 women across the world. She speaks for Islam. And the entire Muslim community of India, who when the authorities asked them to take the militants who attacked Mumbai in 2008, said resoundingly and collectively, no, we will not let the terrorists be buried with us. The media and those who profit from the narrative of Islam versus the West are never going to tell you my story or the stories of these Muslims, who constitute the vast majority of Muslims around the world. But just because you may not hear us, it doesn't mean we're not speaking out. And just because you may not see us on TV, it doesn't mean we don't exist. If you vote against the motion, I would argue you're voting against the moderate voices of mainstream Islam and telling the terrorists that you agree with their version. I urge you to vote for the motion. Thank you.
Thank you, Zeta Khan. Our motion is Islam is a religion of peace. You have heard the opening statement in support of this motion. Now to speak first against the motion that Islam is a religion of peace, I'd like to introduce Ayan Hirsi Ali, a very, very well-known dissident born in Somalia, fled to the Netherlands where she was a member of the parliament, the Dutch parliament. Now she's in the United States, once again on a case of asylum because, Ayan?
Because I had to live with, basically, I was afraid for my life.
Ladies and gentlemen.
In the 21st century, in a free country.
Ladies and gentlemen, Ayan Hirsi Ali.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm surprised by the motion itself. When I first heard it, it reminded me of the academic question, how many angels can dance on the head of a pin? And I'd think, well, if you do the salsa or the cha-cha, not many. Why are we not having a motion on, is Christianity a religion of peace? Is Judaism a religion of peace, etc.? Because those would be academic motions. Unfortunately, the motion, Islam is a religion of peace, is not academic. I respect and admire Zeba Khan, and I want to acknowledge the fact that you indeed are a demonstration of the assimilation of a Muslim individual, a Muslim woman, into Western society, into an American society, that you come from a middle-class family that was very eclectic and respected pluralism. I respect that very much, and I admire you for it, and I think you are an example to others. However, I disagree with you that you represent Islam or that you speak for Islam. The problem that is inherent in Islam from the time of its foundation up to this moment is who speaks for Islam. And I'll get to that later on. Is it Zeba Khan or is it Faisal Shahzad, who was also a middle-class man, went to business school, married an American woman, had two children, lived just like you, like many of you. And yet he made a different choice based on a combination of piety and politics. And that's what Islam is. And before I go on, let me define the key terms of the motion. First, religion. The most common definition of religion you will find is the universal quest of humans in search of the sacred or the holy. That search is expressed intellectually, it's expressed in practice, it is expressed in fellowship. And you look at a religion like Islam, on an intellectual level, it was expressed by the founder of Islam as a demolition of all other gods. Polytheism had to end, and all humanity had to be united under one God. From those of you who are familiar with history, and I think a crowd like this is, you know that no monotheistic religion can be a religion of peace. No monotheistic religion is a religion of peace. And definitely not Islam. Monotheistic religions know periods, lengthy periods of peace, but they also know lengthy periods of war. In terms of practice, yes, in Islam, you practice charity, you go to Hajj, you pray, all of that. But in terms of practice, there's also the expression, there's the concept of jihad. And I find it a pity that Ziba Khan did not mention that concept, which is central to Islam's conquests and Islam's success. The founder of Islam, Muhammad, in his lifetime, conducted 65 campaigns of war that were all successful. And that militaristic history of Islam is well documented. Just go Google it. And if you don't find it on Google, go to all those former empires that were conquered. The combination of a history of empire, of conquest, also leaves a legacy behind. And that legacy is the thrusting together of people of different ethnicities, languages, etc. So even if that empire declines, the likelihood of conflict, of war, is probable. It's high, especially where there is a fault line. That's where Samuel Huntington had a point. That history of militarism, combined with the legacy of empire, those two points alone belie the motion tonight that Islam is a religion of peace. But that's not all. When empires decline, those who are defeated, and the Muslim empire declined, those who are defeated sometimes find themselves in a state of victimhood. That state of victimhood is exploited by the leadership or those self-appointed leaders of Islam. And what do you see? You see a number of people, and I concede it's a minority, who believe that Islam is under siege. A mentality of victimhood tells those who are conquered, who are vanquished, that the problem was caused by external powers, not by us. And that systematic denial within Islam after the 19th century to blame only outsiders exempt Islam from blame, from the explanation what went wrong. Yes, it was external. Yes, Muslims were humiliated. Yes, they were conquered. Yes, they were colonized. But how much was also because of the flaws of Islam? And that takes me to the point of absolutism. When the West went into its Islam, into its scientific revolution, why wasn't it Muslims? Muslims were the first scientists, arithmetic, logic, etc. They were great. Why didn't they get into that scientific revolution? Why were they left behind? Was it only because of external factors, or were there internal flaws? That combination of a status of victimhood and the absolutism, the demand that you can never revise or reflect on the Quran, that you can never, never, ever refute what Muhammad said, you can only follow his example. That absolutism combined with that status of victimhood is also enlarges the likelihood of of conflict. And those two combined, like the other two factors,
Ayaan Hirsi, your time is up.
Thank you. That belies the motion. I'll keep my last two factors for the time I have remaining.
Thank you. We are halfway through the opening round of this Intelligence Square U.S. debate. I'm John Donvan. We have four debaters, two teams of two, fighting it out over this motion, Islam is a religion of peace. You have heard from the first two debaters in their opening statements, and now on to the third. I'd like to introduce Majid Nawaz, who is director of the Quilliam Foundation. And he is in a way, has an amazing biography. Several years back would have been America's nightmare. He was a radical. He was imprisoned in Egypt while on a trip there, though he's born in the UK, was in Egypt and tortured for being a radical, and something happened to you in prison, a 180-degree turn in one sentence. What was it?
In one sentence?
Yeah.
We're talking about 4 years there.
Yeah.
Amnesty International. But I'll explain that in my, hopefully.
Fair
in my
enough. Ladies and gentlemen, Majid Nawaz.
Thank you. Could I indulge the audience and just ask for a round of applause for Zeba's mum? She's just over there. I think she did a wonderful job. Yeah. To raise your daughter to speak Hebrew in the current climate is amazing, and I applaud you. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for giving me this opportunity. I want to begin by just stating what this debate is not about. This debate is not about making excuses for terrorism. Basically, my career is to challenge extremism and terrorism in the West and also in Muslim-majority countries. I've just flown right in from Pakistan, where I've been building the foundations for the first nationwide social movement to challenge extremism and promote democratic values in Pakistan. And I'm proud to announce that just today we gained our 10,000th member on Facebook. So this debate, this debate is not about making excuses for suicide bombers, even inside Israel. We make no apologies and no excuses on this panel for terrorism, for extremism, and for people who kill innocent civilians, including inside Israel. This debate acknowledges, we on our panel, Zeba and myself, acknowledge that Muslims do need to speak out against extremism and to challenge it, and more Muslims need to do that more actively. We acknowledge that Muslims bear a responsibility in reclaiming their faith from those, the minority, who have hijacked Islam and who have captured the public imagination in their definition of Islam. We acknowledge that, and I am, in my own person, a manifestation of that effort, as is Zeba in the way she was raised. So we acknowledge that as well. This debate, in fact, is an appeal. It's not also, before I move to the fact that it's an appeal, it's also not a threat. So we're not going to argue here tonight that if you don't vote for the motion, that somehow Muslims are going to rise up and attack you for insulting Islam. That's not the case. This is an appeal. And it's an appeal to your good sense and your good character and to what you know inside you. This is actually not a debate for Islam at all. This is a debate for peace. And we are not arguing for Islamic peace. We are arguing for Islam to be, with all other religions and all other beliefs and those who have no faith, to be part of the effort to create peace in the world. So this is a debate for peace. It's a debate, and I'm asking you all to vote tonight, not for Islam, but to vote for peace and to help contribute the efforts of all of us around the world who are working for peace. Because there were people like me who spent 13 years of our life working to create hatred. I used to believe that Islam is not a religion of peace. In fact, I used to believe that Islam mandates war. I used to believe and propagate across the world in more than three countries that Islam mandates war and mandates the creation of a state that will have at its heart of its foreign policy a policy to create conquest. I called it jihad. I believed Islam was not a religion of peace because I adopted an ideology at 16 years old and stuck with that until my imprisonment and then after I was released from prison when I was 28 years old. By that time I had established this ideology in Pakistan and in Denmark and contributed to its growth in Egypt. But I learnt in prison two things. One was what I'm appealing to you here today, and that was when people hand out an olive branch, it does work. People I had considered my enemy, people I had considered the enemy of my people, Amnesty International, with their advocation of human rights that I believed was a tool to colonize the minds of Muslims, adopted me as a prisoner of conscience. And by handing me that olive branch, I recognized that there was goodness in the world, and there were people who, regardless of the provocation they find in the world today, are still willing to fight for peace, and are still willing to redefine the debate. And that's what I'm asking you to do here tonight. Because by redefining the debate, and by insisting that they would not allow my hatred to define for them the way in which they viewed me, they changed my heart. I went on and took that message forward and helped establish the world's first counter-extremism think tank in the West, then went into Pakistan to help establish the first nationwide counter-extremism movement in Pakistan. And as I said, we have 10,000 supporters before we've even launched of Muslims from Pakistan who are helping us to redefine the debate, who are not allowing the minority of extremists to hijack Islam, to monopolize its definition, and then define for us all that this should be a world of war, not just Islam as a religion of war, but as you heard from our co-panelist here on the other side, all religions should be religions of war in their minds. Whether that's because they want to fight or because they're not believers in religions and they wish to challenge religion from that basis. And so I make an appeal to all of you tonight to help us redefine this debate. And the second thing that happened to me in prison that helped me change my mind was that I had the opportunity, I won't say good fortune because it wasn't really that, but the opportunity to mix with some of the leading founding jihadists of the world inside an Egyptian prison, ironically built by the British. And what I learned was that I had been extremely arrogant. I had suffered from the failure that I saw here tonight in my respected colleague's presentation. I had failed to contextualize history. And when I was this young and angry 24-year-old, who, yes, had grievances, who'd been stabbed at multiple times growing up on the streets of Essex, who had been falsely arrested on a number of occasions because of racial profiling. I was a very angry young man. But I went to men in prison who had been in prison since I was 3 years old, and then I met them at 24. And they had abandoned their previous terrorist ideology, and I had the arrogance to try and convince them that they had sold out, that they didn't understand that true Islam was a religion of war. And they said to me, young lad, come and sit down. We'll tell you a story or two. And over the course of the 4 years, after having learnt Arabic, after having memorized half of the Quran, after having studied the theology, though myself not being too much of a religious man, I came to the conclusion that Islam had been hijacked and abused and politicized by something that I now refer to as Islamism, the modern ideology, that owes more to post-World War I European fascism than it does to the traditions of Islam. And these former jihadists, among them the assassins of Egypt's former president, Anwar Sadat, who was killed in 1981, they had come to the same conclusions. And so I appeal to all of you, as my time runs out, there's much more to say, to vote to help us all to redefine this motion, to redefine this world, because only by refusing to accept the paradigms that we find imposed upon us, can we refute change. And that's exactly how the civil rights movement in America tackled this issue when they were faced with such situations in the past. Thank you for your patience and thank you for your time.
Our motion is Islam is a religion of peace. And now to speak against the motion, Douglas Murray. He's a best-selling author and founder and director of the Center for Social Cohesion, also a citizen of the United Kingdom, a member of the Church of England. Until recently, you said that your study of the Quran, you said this in print, made you an atheist.
That's right. I said Muhammad made me an atheist. The publisher said at the time, that's a pretty provocative headline. I said, well, get somebody to do the next one. She said, I could find a Catholic who could say Muhammad made me a Catholic. I said, how about trying to make it a three-part article and get the third one, somebody saying Muhammad made me a Jew. And that one would be the trouble.
Douglas Murray, ladies and gentlemen.
Well, thank you. Well, thank you. It's a great pleasure to be here tonight. I'm sorry to make this panel rather Brit-centric after my colleague Majid. This isn't an attempt by us to have a British takeover of the old colony or anything like that. But I was coming earlier from my own fallen empire, referring back to my friend and colleague Ayan's comments earlier, and I was reading the paper, as I'm sure all of you were doing earlier today. Majid finished his comments by talking about the importance of changing paradigms. I'm not sure this is about paradigms. I think it's about facts. Here are some facts in my newspaper earlier. The Times Square bomber, of course, a man just up the road from here who tried to kill thousands of people. Only, by the way, didn't manage it because he set the 24-hour timing device to 7 a.m. instead of 7 p.m. 1,900 hours was what it was meant to be. If he had have got that bit right, thousands of New Yorkers would have died earlier this year again. I see further in the paper 12 suspects arrested in France in a network trying to recruit people to go and fight American and other troops in Afghanistan. I turn to another page of the newspaper in the city I've just flown off from this morning, a Muslim London Underground worker who had written to his wife, who's off to try to become a martyr for Allah, as he says. He says, more than anything, I wish Allah to grant me martyrdom. Ladies and gentlemen, we have to look at facts. We should also just quickly, if I may, refer something to the wording of tonight's debate. Ayaan's already mentioned this, but I mean, let me put it this way. You're, I'm sure, a liberal-minded New York audience, or at least I hope you are. We'll see. But I imagine that if the motion we had here tonight was Christianity is a religion of peace, we get to the Q&A, perhaps even before, and somebody would say, if the other side were arguing for that, somebody would say, what about the Crusades? What about that? And then there'd be some other clever clogs who'd say, what about that Florida pastor the other week? That was a nasty business. That's Christianity for you. If we'd had tonight, Judaism is a religion of peace, the other side were trying to argue that. Sure as anything, there'd be people popping up in the hall tonight saying, oh, there's this bit in one of the Old Testament books, really, really bad. All sorts of massacres going on. Why don't you talk about that? There might even be people trying to say that the argument that Judaism was a religion of peace couldn't be argued because people would say, look at what Israel is doing. It isn't that a direct response, and so on. So let's not have a debate about Islam and whether or not Islam is a religion of peace without talking about the facts to do with Islam. It's an absurd situation we're in, where nothing that anyone does whilst being Muslim is any responsibility of Islam's. Yet anything anyone does whilst being a Christian or a Jew is responsibility of all Christians, all Jews. Let's make this as straightforward as I can. Take the categorization that eminent scholars like Bernard Lewis, Ibn Warraq have made. Let's say Islam is a very, very complex thing. And the best way I can do this in the very short time I have is say you have three Islams. Islam 1, 2, and 3. Islam 1, the Quran and the life of Muhammad and the Hadith. Islam 2, the tradition of the Sharia. Islam 3, what Muslims do now. The first of those things, Islam, the Quran, and so on, is bad. It is bad. There is a lot of violence in it. And what's worse, the peaceful verses are superseded by the violent verses. The violent verses also, sadly, are more numerous in number. Then you've got the life of Muhammad. Again, a bad man. A very bad man, it has to be said. Not a great role model, if you look at it. Takes child brides, abuses a small girl, multiple wives, himself a warrior, himself a war criminal, himself beheads Jews. This, I would have thought, would be a signal of not great peacefulness. Then you've got the tradition of the Sharia. Again, not great peacefulness. Still no schools of Sharia that people in this hall would want to submit to. And thirdly, what Muslims do now. Thankfully, there is some hope in that one. Because most Muslims, thank goodness, I almost said thank God, but old habits die hard. Most Muslims don't do what those texts say because they exercise their judgment as moral beings without having to refer to defunct holy books. Now look, I wish that Zebra and Majid were the spokespeople of Islam. It would be lovely, although in Majid's case it would have taken rather too long if everyone had to go for 14 years preaching the downfall of America and then said, no, not so much. But we are where we are. Anyhow, I wish they spoke for Islam. It would be great. But the fact is that tonight the organisers of this debate asked a number of clerics. None of them would show. Specifically, they wouldn't show and debate against Ayaan Hirsi Ali. Myself, I don't think they cared. But But no, it's very interesting that they will not debate. Time and again, Muslim, the actual leaders of your religion will not debate this. And you're left with people like we have here. The reason why is, of course, is that the leaders of the religion show such terrible lessons. It is not a small thing. It's not, as it were, a detail. It's not like a wacky Florida pastor. That you've got the largest Sunni state of Saudi Arabia, the most important Sunni state in the world, the most extraordinary closed prison of a society. It's not a detail, it's not a one-off nut job that the Shiite Republic of Iran is what it is, led by the people it's led by. That is not an accident, it's not a detail. The thing that worries me is that although tonight we hear from the fellow panelists here about how Islam is a religion of peace, the fact is that the people who are making the decisions in the religion, the people who are preaching in the religion, the heads of that religion, people like Sheikh Haradawi, who broadcasts anti-Semitic, the most appalling filth every week on the main networks, that is the faith that's speaking for you guys. I wish that, Ziba, you were on every week on Al Jazeera, but you're not. Karadawi is. The problem is that Islam is an unstable component, as a religion, an unstable component. 1,000 years ago, the Mu'tazilites tried to reform the religion. They were wiped out. The fact is that Islam is many things, many, many things. But to say it's a religion of peace is nonsense. It's to ignore reality. It's to ignore very difficult but necessary facts. Not paradigms, but facts. To say that Islam is a religion of peace is to say something based entirely on hope. It's to elevate a hope into truth. And I hope, as you all know, history teaches us that's a very bad thing to do. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Smith. And that concludes round one of this Intelligence Squared U.S. debate. And here's where we are. We have heard opening statements. We're going